this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and this is going to be one of the last episodes that I'm filming here anyways on a farm on Maui, since I fly back to the mainland tomorrow. So I'm glad I'm here for you guys, but unfortunately it's pretty late in the day, so I'm going to give you guys a condensed version, which I know a lot of you guys will appreciate, you know, other than my 1 hour long videos, because I think I got about 45 minutes left of sun. So we're going to try to fit as much as I possibly can in this episode, so you guys should learn from an actual farm, permaculture designed farm that's actually running and growing some great stuff. And they got a farm stand, like self-serve style here. Right now it's the end of the day, so they don't have anything, but it looks like, you know, they had recently papayas and pomelos and some pumpkins and chermoyas available. So that the farmer's market here in Kula, Wednesday morning, ran into the farmer who actually is like, hey, do you make videos? I was watching your video just a couple nights ago. And I'm like, yeah. So then we got the chat, man, really cool guy, the farmer that's working the land here. He knows a lot of stuff. He comes from a background in farming and he's doing a lot of cool stuff. So I was really tickled when he invited me over and took me on a little tour a little bit earlier. He's now busy with his kids making him dinner. So I'm going to go ahead and take you guys around the farm and share with you guys what you're missing from not being here. So one of the cool things I like about the farm here is that it's really designed well. There's so many nice walking pathways that are perfect for a farm tour, right? At my house, it's not set up for tours. My walkways are very small because I want to maximize the amount of food I could grow in a small space. Lucky enough, this has been established for many years. They have some really cool trees that hopefully I'll get to show you guys, like the jabatkaba over on this side. But it's been established for quite a while, and it's about 2 acres, so they have really nice planting of different perennial fruit trees and other perennial shrubs that are all edible. They got an aquaponic system. They got different areas with a little greenhouse, shade house, and lots of different garden beds. So let's check it out. One of the things I really like about the farm here is the biodiversity here on this farm. There are so many different things growing. There's like vetiver. I don't know if you guys could see that over there. They got like just like borders of comfrey. It's just really done so beautiful, and I wish my girlfriend Lauren was here to view it, because you know she's gone along with farm shoots with me, but she likes very few of them. But I really think she'd like this, and hopefully it'll give her a vision of what our farm that we have together one day, maybe even on Maui, will look like, and she'll approve of the design, because this is just very well done. So they got like different border crops here. They're trying to cover the ground as much as possible with wood chips or other materials, as well as a living mulch or just the weeds if they kind of like get short on the labor. They also got this guy right here, which is a edible hibiscus, cranberry hibiscus. And they got like down over there, like edible nasturtiums. Plus they got some ornamental plants mixed in. Oh, they got lilikoi over here. Over there, I think they got an avocado or no, mango tree. And then right here, this is actually a cotton tree here. I don't know if you guys can see like the cotton balls. Oh, and I want to cover this. I don't know if you guys can see it on the camera because it's kind of far away. But over here, they got the one, an Okinawan spinach, they call it. It's definitely a genera. I was wondering if this is a genera procumbens or a genera, a different kind. But it's just like the Okinawan spinach. And this is one of the perennial greens that you guys will want to grow if you guys live here on Maui or anywhere on the Hawaiian Islands. This one, literally, you just plant once and it just keeps growing and expanding. You could be harvesting off it all the time to have a never-ending plethora of greens to eat. It's one of the easiest crops. Unlike some of the crops that we'll see in the field, which are more annual crops that you got to keep replanting every so many months because they'll basically end their life cycle. This guy continues to grow, one of the most valuable. And they do have the cuttings and they do make the plants available here. So this is definitely a really good resource for you guys if you live on Maui. Let's go ahead and continue our garden tour. All right, so we're gonna take you on a garden tour, maybe kind of a walking tour here. As you guys can see, the ground is littered with like cotton balls. Like, John, why are there cotton balls on the ground? That's kind of weird. Well, if you look up, that's why. There's cotton in their trees. So this is a Hawaiian cotton, and you know, that's how they look. The balls are maybe like closed like that. Then the balls kind of open up like that, and then the cotton just drops out. So the cotton's the fiber, and if you were in there and crushing the cotton, inside you'd find some little balls here. I could feel it right there. And there's like inside there, right there, if you feel it, is a little seed. And so that's how this tree spreads its seeds. really cool. And now you're all wearing cotton. Unfortunately, most of the cotton grown is of the GMO variety. This kind is not. But yeah, as you guys can see on this walking tour, they got chayote squash vines growing on up, really taking over. Lots of ground cover. They're using like purple sweet potato as a ground cover. And lots of cool stuff. Oh, here's a propagation little greenhouse with a cover on it. They got lots of cool stuff starting in here. Oh, and I wanted to show you guys this real quick. We'll put the camera down. So I love that every time I come to a new farm, I get to learn new stuff. And this is really cool. So what they're using here to start their little babies is actually not just a standard like a 10 by 20 tray that most people use, kind of like looks like this. You know, they're not that deep, right? The roots can't like really dig down. So they're not really establishing good plants if you're doing it in something really thin. So they use these guys, which are like some kind of harvest bin, and they're quite thick. And to me, if you ever had one of those worm bins, I think they're out of Oregon, these are kind of like those same parts of that. So I'm like, what are they using all these worm bins to grow their plant starts in? And actually, they're not quite worm bins. They are actually harvest bins that the worm company found out works for a worm bin, right? So that's a whole nother topic. But anyways, they direct seed in here. Once they get pretty big, then they'll pluck them out, and then they'll put them back in another one of these guys, but spaced appropriately. And they'll let the roots get nice and long, and then they'll finally dig these guys out and then transplant them into their gardens. By far, transplanting many different seedlings is the best way to do it. Of course, some seeds can be is more easier and best direct sown. But you know, if you're direct seeding things, that's when the birds and things and the young baby plants are a lot more fragile. So if they got good, established, healthy plants to put in to their garden, they're gonna be much more successful. So this is a tip that you guys at home could also use. All right, so now I wanna show you guys some more of the farm here. Oh man, check this tree right here is one of my favorite trees here. It's actually an ever-bearing mulberry. So, you know, this mulberry produces, you know, year-round quite often. And now let me see if I can show you guys some of the little ripe mulberries on there. Look at that. Oh my God. I'm gonna have to reach up there, and I wish I had more time here to harvest a bunch and eat them, but I gotta continue this video for you guys. All right, here's the easy way to harvest a mulberry. If it's too tall, take the branch, pull it down to you so you don't have to climb up. And let's see, here's a nice black one right here. Make sure there's no bugs right there. And go ahead and try this baby. Definitely good. Could be a little bit riper. Dried mulberry is one of my favorite fruits. All right, so as we continue our tour here, you know, here's a nice little pathway. Lots of different citrus trees. You guys can see citrus just dropping on the ground. It's so abundant on this farm. Oh, and check this out, man. You guys probably just see greenery, right? What I see is like an overgrown lilikoi like bush that was once like over this like wire cage structure. Utility like grade like stock panels, but it just kind of went crazy. So they have lots of different lilikoi or passion fruit, and they have several different varieties. As you look around the farm, one of the things I really like is if you look and you see like the ground is like mostly covered. There's like banana plants, and oh, they got even things like artichokes, and oh, they're growing this one right here, the white flowers, that's tobacco. And they use some tobacco in making some preparations for pest controls, right? Oh, and over here, really important plant you guys are looking at right now in the main focus, right in the center. That's milkweed. So milkweed, you know, it's not necessarily an edible plant, but it's a beneficial plant because it'll attract beneficial insects to your garden, including butterflies and whatnot. Very important. And below the milkweed, check it out, man. They got a little bed of strawberries. Definitely really cool. And this is where it opens up into some of their more annual style beds. Lots of different things growing. Landscape really well, always covering the ground with wood chips and other crops if not planted in the beds. Oh, and check this out, I gotta show you guys this, right? They got bananas. They got about like, I don't know, 5 or 6 different varieties of bananas here. All right, let's go ahead and continue the tour for you guys. As you guys can see, they're just using like banana leaves and other things to mulch and cover the ground. This is a new area where they got some new trees planted, and in between the trees, they're growing other things in the meanwhile. So of course, some beautiful nasturtiums, and this is a flower that I would encourage you guys to grow. Not only are all the edible flowers that you're seeing here in this shot the yellow ones and the orange ones all edible, so they should sell edible flower packs at the farmer's market because they sell for a lot of money. But also all the greens you see in front of me, the nasturtium greens, are also edible. Now the nasturtium flowers have a nice hot peppery style flavor. The greens are even more hot and spicy, but to add a little bit of greens into a salad, oh, it's amazing. And let's not forget about the little immature seed pods of the nasturtium. Those are known as poor man's capers and can be fermented into like a caper-like substitute, you know, when not fully mature. All right, moving on further. Thought Haas avocados only grew in California? Well, check it out, man. This tree is loaded with all kinds of Haas avocados that are growing here on Maui. Now, I think growing Haas avocados in Maui is quite silly because there's so many other cool and interesting varieties of avocados. Oh, and I gotta put the camera down for this one. Let me show you guys this. So the next thing I want to share with you guys, actually, we're in an orchard here, and there's different kinds of fruit trees all around me, maybe spaced, maybe 20 feet or so. And they're doing a few things, very important. Number one, underneath the trees, they prune them up so that they're not like hanging on the ground, very important. And that they could have easy access. They're keeping them pruned so they could harvest, them without having to climb too much. But all the pruning material that they cut off the trees go right underneath the tree. So you guys can see all the prunings that they've done. They got comfrey mixed in, some coming up from down below. But all these old leaves and things from the tree above just get chopped up, chopped and dropped right down below. So the leaves and the wood can all break down over time. And guess what? The tree is gonna feed the tree the nutrients it needs. So they have to use very little additional inputs to feed their trees additional nutrients. Now the other thing I want to show you guys is that they're maximizing their space. Even though they got 2 acres, which is a lot of space to grow food in, they want to make the maximum use of it, because the more food they could grow, the more food they could offer at the farmer's market, you know, the larger the farmer's income. And hey, we all need to make a living. So what they've done in the middle between the trees, maybe like it, if they're 20 feet spacing, it's in between 10 feet, maybe it's 12 feet here, right in the middle, they made a little mini hugel bed. So this is a hugel culture bed. You guys saw it in the last episode. That was a big hugel bed. This is a small one. So they piled up some wood and whatnot down below. They mulched around with some leaves so that the weeds won't overcompete and get in there. And then they just piled on some good topsoil and compost. And they planted some squash. So these are some kind of like squash plants. And that's the new hugel going in right there with the new squash plants. But if you look like right over there, and right over there and right behind me there, you'll see lots of different squash is kind of like vining out, covering the ground, you know, between the trees to grow more of the squash. I think one of the ones they grow is the butternut here. So this way they could maximize their use of the space, number one. Number two, shade the ground to keep the sun off the ground to retain the moisture, and to help build organic matter instead of bare soil. Not too good for building soil fertility, and plus grow more food. I don't know what else you could do to make a farm be more productive. Let's go ahead and move on, and let's show you guys a few more things before the sun goes down. So now I want to show you guys actually another technique they're using. And you might be thinking, John, why they got all those litter boxes on the ground? Well, hey, those were actually intentionally placed there on purpose. Where they go is maybe like to the Sears or other big stores that sell those big fridges and, you know, washers and dryers, and they have large cardboard boxes. And even sometimes if they get Amazon shipments, they're using their Amazon boxes spread out, you know, to basically cover the ground, to retain the moisture, to smother out the weeds in the area, and to provide fertility, because the cardboard will break down and provide nutrients for the tree over time. So that's actually in this area right here. Now, if I laid down cardboard on the ground, number one, you want to remove the plastic tape. And number two, once you lay the cardboard down, you know, I try to put like wood chips or other materials over it, so that they just don't all blow all over the place. But yeah, I would definitely encourage all you guys to use your cardboard boxes instead of just throwing them in garbage, right? They are a great resource. Another way I like to use them is actually take those and shred them up through a nice paper shredder that shreds into nice small confetti style pieces, and then add it to my compost pile to supercharge my compost pile with a good rich carbon source. So here's another area of their farm that I would like to share with you guys actually. And in this area, basically they have kind of like row crops, but they're not really planting them in rows. What they've done is they basically double dug or moved some soil and kind of piled it up on top of the existing level, maybe like 8 inches tall. And so I would call that like a raised bed without sides is what I like to call them. And they planted fairly closely They got lettuce in this one, lettuce in the one there, lettuce here, maybe some spinach down below, and some yacone growing. And so this is one of the techniques they use to like have some annual crops mixed within between like different fruit trees that have, you know, maybe a 40-foot spacing at this point in the garden. And so besides just growing the annuals, they're growing also many other perennial crops that I'd like to share with you guys next that kind of like have a longer season or growth cycle than maybe just the standard lettuce. So over in this area of the farm, what they got growing is a bunch of stuff, man. I see some vining squash plants. I see some like collard greens. I see some artichoke plants growing. And they got different sections with the taro growing. Now, there's not a big call for, you know, people or white people to buy the taro from the farmer's market. So what they do here is they turn a lot of the products that they would normally be able to sell, like a bunch of, you know, kale or collard greens or even their chayote squash that they might sell for maybe a couple bucks a pound, they actually value add it. So they'll basically lactic acid ferment their chayote squash, which maybe I'll get to show you guys in the end if it's not too dark, and turn that into basically chayote squash pickles, and then they'll sell that for a lot more. And so that's what they should do with their taro here. And they've discovered that certain taros take longer or shorter to grow. So this kind right here with the purple stem, you know, grows a lot slower. And when it grows, it makes a little small taro. And the one over there, it actually makes a big taro. So they're kind of investing the same amount of time for a lot more food on the other side. So I said, hey, maybe value add this and make some poi out of it and charge more for it and call it, you know, a heirloom taro poi made the traditional way. So there's always a way to basically, you know, add value and create value from your farming methods so that you could ensure your crops make the most money. And we saw that in the last episode that I filmed here on Maui. Let's go ahead and show you guys maybe a few more areas before the sun goes down. So what we're looking at next for you guys is actually a double dug bed. So I'm actually sitting in the part that was double dug and topped over. And over on here, they got lots of greens and they're interplanting and companion planting with things like the onions here. So you got the onions and the lettuce, and I see some beets here coming up also. And so the thing is, they're planting the same crop in different locations. So if there's an outbreak of slugs or snails or pests in one location, hopefully their pests are not gonna find their way to this bed of lettuce or whatever. So this way is ensuring they're gonna have at least some kind of crop that's saleable in the end. And I want to ensure you guys do that too. You know, plant the same thing in different areas to be more successful with gardening. I often do that. In this bed, I'll plant lettuce, and then on the other side of my yard, I'll plant lettuce in another bed. So there, and then it'll be interesting because like I'll find this lettuce grew better than this side. I mean, this side has a little bit better soil, and you'll just find things do a little bit better, and then you'll know that for next year, next season, and you could just grow things in the place it likes to grow the best. Of course, one of the best greens you guys should grow here on Hawaii that is long-standing and lasts a long time are the dandelion greens or the chicory greens. This is a whole bed that looks like it's actually not getting harvested enough. And I talked to my other farmer friend Ryan today on island, and he said he's been growing these guys and they haven't gotten a flower or anything for like over a year. And he just continues to pull leaves off this and sell bunches of dandelion greens to the locals. To eat. Dandelion greens are one of the most important leafy greens you guys could eat. It's kind of like a bitter green and a really good in detoxifying, especially if you're into juicing or blending. One of the best things you could be juicing or blending. And I want to encourage you guys to grow it at your home if you live here in the islands, because it does grow so easily, and it's basically you plant it once, it's going to give you guys some food for a long time. So I'd rather grow the chicory or dandelion here instead of the lettuce that does not quite last as long. All right, let's continue on with our tour. As you guys can see, like there's just all these beds that are nice and raised. Here's like onion sets they planted, really nice. Oh, and here's a really good example. They have sugarcane, they're growing sugarcane here, and they basically just juiced all the sugarcane, and then they laid all the sugarcane out as mulch in a pathway to keep, you know, the mud down and also to cover the soil. I mean, here's another example of just using the sugarcane, banana leaves and whatnot for mulch. And here's some more of their taro. They've also created really many cool structures. You guys can see there in the background, you know, to grow the chayote squash up. And let's see, here's a loquat tree we're planting. Oh, and man, over on this side, there's so many things happening here. They got the fennel growing. Let's see if I can get a shot of the fennel. Oh, so they got the fennel growing back over there. And let's go ahead and continue on this tour. Right here, we're looking at a loquat tree, one of my favorites. But if we look over there below the loquat tree, you'll see, like, starting over there on the ground, that's lettuce. The lettuce bed kind of like turns and twists around underneath the loquat tree and continues and makes like a loop. So that's a continuous bed of lettuce. Definitely really cool. And then it kind of like mixes into some pineapples and then some other plants down below here, which are actually one of the best ground covers you guys could have. If you have a space and you're not sure what you're going to plant there, then I would encourage you guys to plant the purple sweet potato. And that's the purple sweet potato vine you guys are seeing above. You could cook up the greens for eating, and of course it's going to make the purple sweet potatoes one of the best starchy root crops you guys could grow. Of course, right above that though, they also have papayas growing above, and of course, over yonder, they got some bananas growing as well. So yeah, lots of stuff cranked in to this food forest here. All right, let's continue the tour. So over on this fence line, they got the chayote squash vine. This is another no-brainer to grow if you have some space or at least some trellis space here in Hawaii. The chayote squash grows really well here, provides you lots of food to eat. And as I said, they ferment their chayote squash vine. Walking up here further, they got a little chicken coop. Anyways, with chickens, and let's see. Oh, I want to show you guys this tree right here. It's a clove tree. Let's see. So one of my favorite trees here on the farm is this guy right here. I think this is a dwarf Samoan tree. They think it was a dwarf, but actually it's just a slow growing variety of coconut, actually. And so it's actually harvestable while you're just standing on the ground without any ladder. Although that being said, it could get hundreds of feet tall, but because it's slow growing, it's not going to happen as quickly. So I really like that a lot. And coconuts, to me anyways, are one of the most valuable things you guys could be planting here in Hawaii if you're at the proper elevation. So it's definitely getting darker here. I want to show you guys a few more things. One of the best crops they've been growing here is actually the broccolini, and it takes maybe like 55 days until it's harvestable, and then it's harvestable for a long season. So definitely another one for you guys. Now it's like, I don't know what they don't have growing on here. They have so many different kind of plants growing, and they even have their own aquaponic system that's set up in here, and then behind it is actually their pond with all the tilapia. So they have a taro currently in this aquaponic system, perennial peanut, all kinds of other cool stuff. They're currently experimenting with the lettuce, and they got water hyacinth growing as well. But I think the sun's almost down, but I want to show you guys one last thing that might even be already too dark to show you guys. All right, so as you guys can see, some of the lights are coming on since the evening, but yeah, this farm is just very well done. It's nice, like ornamental, walkable. You could clearly see the lines, the beds, what they're trying to do, all the different things they're growing. I'm just completely amazed by it. And it just makes me want to get back to my garden soon. But yeah, this is like on a much larger scale, full on farm. Anyways, what I want to show you guys next actually is right between these two trees right here. Let's see if we could go inside and I'll show you guys one of the ways they build fertility aside from the composting. All right, so I don't know if you guys can see me, but I'm like right between two trees. These are known as Java Takaba trees. Maybe I'll show you guys in a minute. I'll shine the light on them. I got the cell phone light here because it's kind of like getting dark. And this is a really good place, you know, right between the canopy of the trees. It's kind of a nice, dark, secluded place. So what we're looking at here, you can see it's basically a worm bin that they have a nice lid for. And this is just basically one of those big tubes they put for maybe like sewage tubes, big black tube they cut in half. And if we open this up for you guys can't probably see in there too much, but basically I just see like literally thousands of worms. Some of them are pretty long, man. Maybe try to get you guys a close up of that. They got bananas and your cone and all kinds of stuff. And when I open it up, man, they don't like the light. They're kind of moving away really fast. But yeah, worms, definitely one of the best ways you guys could be creating some fertility, you know, not only in a worm bin, but actually just take these worms and put them and spread them around your garden. The good news about the farm here is that they will sell the worms if you need some. Last shot for you guys, getting real dark, but we're gonna go ahead and use my iPhone. But this is just really cool, must look really cool in the dark. Look at this. As we come up on this tree here, if we go in between the branches, these are just the stems of the tree, and look, this tree's got warts. Look at all these little balls growing off the tree, man. That's crazy, eh? And it just goes up and up. All those little balls, the warts, bad disease. Just kidding, actually. This is known as a Java tecama tree. And this is a really cool fruit, man. Just like the blueberries are purple and got the purple pigments, the anthocyanins. This is one of the most nutritious tropical fruits you guys could be eating. These are like blueberries of the tropics. And I want to encourage you guys to grow some Java tecamas if you are able. The peels don't actually taste the best. If you spit out the peel, spit out the seed, and you get the white flesh on the inside, they're definitely really good. But you could even just pop them in your mouth, eat the skin, seed, and all. It's actually quite delicious.
So as you guys can see, I'm no longer at the farm. It got too dark to film, so I basically just grabbed some Java tecamas, talked to the farmer, and I took off. So now I'm here at the hotel room, gonna finish up this video for you guys. I got a few Java tecamas to go. This is what they look like. They kind of look like muscadine grapes, but they are not related for sure. And we're gonna go ahead and try one on camera for you guys, let you guys know what it tastes like. Right here. That's what it looks like on the inside. And if you spit out the seed and the skin, just suck out the inside pulp. It's kind of sweet like a grape, but it doesn't taste like a grape. It tastes like a grape crossed with a mangosteen. But maybe you guys never had mangosteen, so you guys wouldn't know what this tastes like, right? I personally like to eat the seed and the skin of the mangosteen, you know, for the most amount of nutrition. And that way, it's definitely not that sweet. If you had like a bad blueberry that's like not sweet, it's kind of what it tastes like, maybe even a little bit tad bit worse. The skin's kind of bitter. Seed, maybe not the best to eat anyways. But you guys have a choice. I would encourage you guys to eat the deep pigmented fruits. They're definitely really good. Now, one of the things I learned from this farmer that I actually hadn't heard before is the best way to propagate the Java tecama is to take the full fruit. Take the full fruit and plant it in the ground. Plant it in some dirt, right? Check it out. I mean, the reason for the fruit in the world is because it's a seed-containing vessel, as Chekhov would say, or seed-containing vessel. It actually has a seed with all the water the seed needs to germinate and the outer covering to protect it from the environment, right? So you can just plant this and actually just sprout up, shoot up, and grow a new little baby tree. Of course, you could also eat the fruit and then save the seed and clean the fruit off the seed and then just go ahead and plant the regular seed. But I kind of like that, man, just plant the whole fruit. So I kind of wonder what other fruits could you just take the whole fruit and have the seeds in, plant it in the ground and grow them. I know the Chatu squash is definitely one of them for sure. Any case, as I was leaving the farm, the farmer came up to me and he farms the land, but he does not own the land actually. And he said, "Hey John, man, we can't publish the name of the farm. The owners came up to me and they don't want the name out there, but you can show the footage, but you just can't mention the farm name." So, you know, I like to be respectful of property owners, farm owners, whomever. You know, a lot of farms won't let me film. And I kind of wonder, like, if they don't let me film, what do they have to hide? So, they don't have anything to hide. They're going to let me show the film that you guys just watched. But they won't let me mention the farm name. So, they don't want to take credit or they don't want to get promotion or they just don't want people to know who they are. I mean, for whatever reason, that's cool. I honor that, request for sure. So, I'm not going to tell you guys the farm name. But what I will tell you is if you guys come to Maui, you guys could come to some of the different farmers markets on island, including the one in Kula and the one in Kihei on Lapoa Street. And the farmer will be there. Also, this farm also does tours. So if you pay for tours and you want to tour organic farm, you may end up at this farm. But I can't tell you really anything more because I can't disclose the location or the farm name. But yeah, it was definitely a beautiful farm, and I would encourage you guys to visit if you guys figure out which farm it is. Had a great time out today checking out the farm before my flight home to the mainland. So anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode, learned a few things along the way, and want to know the farm name, hey, please give me a thumbs up. I can't disclose any farm names at this time, but maybe, just maybe, the owners might make a comment down below the video, or who knows what'll happen. But yeah, give a thumbs up. Maybe next trip I'll try to come back and visit the farm again and maybe get a permission to share the name or just film some other cool things that they're doing. They have so many different projects and I had not enough time today to share all of them with you guys so that you guys can enrich your farming and your gardening experiences by learning by example. And that's why I'm really glad I'm able to visit farms and share with you guys what they're doing, so it'll make you better gardeners and farmers. And so with that, I would encourage you guys to click that subscribe button right down below to be notified of new and upcoming episodes that are coming out about every 3 to 4 days on this YouTube channel. Also, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,200 videos at this point in time, educating you guys about all aspects of growing food at home. And especially if you guys are located in Hawaii, go to my homepage, growingyourgreens.com, click that little magnifying glass and type in Hawaii. You'll see all the videos I've done, you know, dozens and dozens of videos here in the Hawaiian Islands that all directly pertain to you guys, no matter which one of the Hawaiian Islands you guys live on, since all the growing conditions are fairly similar. And also be sure to check my other videos on tropical locations. So I quite often go to South Florida, and the South Florida videos are directly applicable to here in Hawaii, as they are to other tropical locations in the world. And to finally, be sure to share this video with some of you guys could think it could help out. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep growing your fresh fruits and vegetables, and eating them too. They're always the best.